is Sky News Real Estate. Smart Investing.
Hello and welcome to Smart Investing. I'm Chris Gray. On tonight's show, how does landlord insurance differentiate from a regular home and contents policy? What's the advantages of using an insurance broker versus going direct? And how do you know whether a real estate agent is lying or telling the truth? Well, joining us tonight is Andrew Fluitsma from Honan Insurance and Charles Tarbey, chairman and owner of Century 21. Now, don't worry, Charles, I'm not going to ask the real estate question to you. That's for Tom Panos later on.
Okay, well, he should know.
Exactly. We'll find out later on. But, Andrew, welcome to the show. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Chris.
So, let's start off with the basics. Why do I even need insurance policy on an investment property?
Oh, I think, Chris, it's like anything. I mean, you've got to consider it as in balance sheet protection. So you've got your own personal balance sheet. You know, you've got debt, you've got equity, and insurance should be considered very much like third tier capital. It's there to protect. You need to consider whether or not you can actually retain that risk or you need to transfer it. And I think ultimately, when you look at the pricing of insurance, it's very easy, or it's the cheapest form of risk management to cover against a catastrophic loss when you can price for certainty.
Now, Charles, I would have thought the average property investor thinks, oh, that's covered by the strata, and it's only when their property turns into a meth lab that they worry that maybe they're not covered.
And I've seen it happen, sadly, within my family, where one of my children's investment property was utilised for, you know, the water bills were getting higher, and then you start to notice some changes. So it is an issue. One of the biggest issues associated with landlord insurance, particularly in the early days, where people thought landlord insurance meant that their rent was covered, and it can be, but in the early days that was not what the policy was about. And the other part of it also was malicious damage, and much of that wasn't covered too. So people who took out landlord insurance really got very little back for it. So over the years it's progressively changed so that if there is malicious damage or if there is a loss of rent, you can insure against that, and it's highly, highly recommended.
Now, Andrew, I'm sure landlord's insurance isn't just one thing. I'm sure there's lots of different things with different policies. So what are maybe some of the intricacies that people should look out for?
Yeah, I think it's important to look at the exclusions first, and typically you're going to be looking at things like pets are going to be excluded, contentious things such as flood, okay, and they're important to remember. I think the important thing to look for is the form on which the policy is written. Is it accidental damage or is it defined events? Okay, and now obviously accidental damage is going to be the situation where the tenant spills over the wine and the entire carpet needs to be replaced, or a child gets a hold of, you know, some nail polish remover and causes a whole heap of damage.
My daughter's done that.
Yeah, that's good. The daughter's
pink.
Yeah, okay. And I guess the defined events piece is, by virtue of defining each event within the policy, is really restricting it and restricting the coverage. So that's something that that needs to be looked at in close detail. The form, the exclusions, and then I guess understanding what they mean for each buyer of the policy.
I love how you blame your daughter when you probably knocked the bottle over yourself while you're doing your nails.
I didn't get up off the couch, even though it was a beige carpet and a pink nail polish. But again, I've been there for 7 years, so I'm reckoning that's wear and tear now, so the landlord will cover it. So, Charles, talking about some of these things like flood, I guess part of that will come down to your property selection.
General insurance.
When you're looking for that investment property in the first place, that straight away we think of Brisbane and parts of Queensland.
Yeah, look, there are some the areas where they won't insure, and that's part of an issue too. Earthquake was an issue with a lot of people. They weren't insured for that. So I think, though, when you look at landlord insurance, it's a whole different ball game altogether. It's not really related to general insurance. It's just about protecting your investment with your tenants and making sure that you get your rent on time and making sure if the kitchen burns down, not through general insurance, but because the tenant and the agent had a battle and they set it on fire, which you've seen. So those sorts of things are really, really important to cover, and a lot of people don't cover them. And so it is highly recommended that they go down that road, particularly with malicious damage and loss of rent. If you look at some of the marketplaces in Australia where the vacancy rates are very high right now, some of those people would have done very well to have had landlord insurance for rent, protective for rent.
Yeah. Now, Andrew, I find it hard enough being an expert at one thing, let alone multiple things. I'm all for mortgage brokers, but for the people that maybe don't want to use them and they're thinking I should go direct, it's always going to be cheaper, do you want to maybe try and sway them the other side and tell them why they should use a broker?
Oh yeah, look, I think it's advice, it's advocacy, it's acumen, independence, and it's commercial buying power, and it's access to a wide range of insurers in reality. And we talk about things like flood. We got treaty restrictions from a particular insurance company in Queensland, and you know, are you going to be able to find the carrier that's going to pick up that flood risk for you, or is it going to extend to malicious damage or rent default? It's really important that particularly now we're heading into what's widely known as a hardening insurance cycle. We've had 20 years of soft market where premiums have been going down. We're now heading into a phase where those premiums through a number of economic factors are pushing up. Insurance companies are restricting cover, there's less capacity in the market, there's less insurers available for harder to place risks. It's very important to go to an independent broker who has access to more markets and can give you the advice around what's required based on the risk profile.
Now, yeah. Charles, you've got a property management business as well, so I guess some of your property managers will get to know what insurance companies are paying out and which aren't.
Yes.
But again, for the average person on the street to do it without a broker or a property manager, they're just going to see two policies and probably pick the cheapest one.
Well, we have two things, and the first one is leverage. If you've got a large portfolio and across the Century 21 organisation, there are literally thousands upon thousands of properties managed, and we've always recommended a couple of different businesses, so we have a strong relationship with them. So you've got leverage in that position. So an agent can go in and say, look, I've got 500 properties with you, and landlord insurance. You can't let me down on this one. So that's really an important one. The other important one is reward for effort. And most, if you go direct to insurance companies or banks, people you're dealing with, there's no extra reward for them. It's part of their normal role. With a broker, it's reward for effort. So they're going to work harder for you because they're going to get rewarded for it. And particularly with mortgages and insurance, there's trail revenue, which continues for the life of policies or the life of loans. And they've got a book value, and that value can be unsold. So if you're going to go with somebody, you've got to go with somebody who's got something to lose. And this is why we talk about discount agents and discount commissions. The lower you pay your agent, the less the agent's going to get, the less interested in reality they're probably going to be. But if I know I've got a percentage of the sale of your property, a percentage of it, I'm going to work a lot harder because it's reward for effort. And I think those things are really critical when you're choosing insurance, real estate or brokers for mortgages.
100%. And that's why I've got about 30 policies with you, because then it's all just everything's together.
That's just
and
a reminder, by the way. It's just a reminder.
Just give me a little nudge under the desk.
Just in case I suddenly go and lose something.
Yeah. I had been reminded this week.
Yeah. Good.
Now, I reckon there's a lot of people that would have their own home, they decide to let a bit out on Airbnb, or they turn it into a full-on investment property, and I would assume a lot of them think that their home and contents is going to cover it. I assume that's probably not the case.
Look, yeah, you're quite right. I mean, each policy needs to be endorsed or extended to cover something like holiday rentals through Airbnb. There's a number of, home and contents policies. And look, you know, insurers look at policy insurances in groups of homogenous risks, okay? So the theory is if I'm going to have an entire street that I'm insuring, one house is going to burn down based on the actuarial study, therefore I can price it, and therefore I can make my return. So the reality is once you start throwing things in there that are different to that group of homogeneous risks, then it's going to make a difference. So therefore, you know, you price it and you endorse it, and it's modelled that way. So that's why there is landlord cover, that's why there is home and contents cover, and that's why they are very different buyers, different markets.
Mm. And look, when it comes to actually claiming on the policy, how easy is it these days?
It should be very easy, and really
if
easy.
You're if you're honest and you've done the right thing.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you've got, you know, your duty of disclosure is the most important thing. Again, you know, and speaking the advocacy of brokers, I mean, the reality is that, you know, if it's a hard and fast claim, if it's an insured peril, if it's material damage and the place burns to the ground, it's going to be covered, okay? Now, the theory, I guess the mantra that we run within our business is that if it's grey, then we pay, because we've got a bunch of specialist, you know, insurance lawyers on staff who are, you know, versed in the Insurance Contracts Act, who'll know things like the onus is upon the insurance company to prove that an exclusion exists to decline a claim. And you can push that really hard. And again, that's that commercial leverage, that's pushing it through. These types of grey area claims really come in liability situations or interpretations of wordings. The reality is a really hard and fast material damage type claim should be paid with ease, and interpretable things do get difficult, and that's where you need the help of somebody who knows what they're doing.
Look, there's no denying that there are some situations where the insurer will look for ways not to pay. And I can say that from personal experience, and I'm sure many people can. In the greater majority, if everything's straightforward, there shouldn't be an issue. But sometimes insurance companies, if it's a big payout, will engage lawyers to find out why they shouldn't pay you. So the people you're paying to cover you are now recruiting lawyers to find out why they shouldn't pay you. And that does happen, so you have to be very careful.
And that's why, I guess, having the in-house lawyers, then that makes it easier, because at least then the customer's not having to pay for that.
Oh, most definitely. And again, it's being versed in the Insurance Contracts Act and what your rights are under that, and knowing how to really work that in the favour of the buyer. That is really important. And again, these guys have seen these, probably most of the debatable claims, a lot.
Now, obviously, meth labs always makes for great TV on A Current Affair and stuff like that. Any other interesting kind of claims that you guys get?
Oh, look, you know, we do see a lot. There's probably a sad trend in those sorts of things at the moment. And we do have, you know, in northwest of Sydney, a major reserve, about $50,000 for a drug lab cleanup. Things to remember about that. And you talked before about the loss of rent or the rental default and the impact that has on an investor. Mm. You know, these things, you know, you're going to have the police involved, you're going to have insurance companies being really wary of the moral hazard, you've got a buyer that's, you know, or an investor that's had, you know, drug dealers in their home or drug manufacturers in their home. There's the environmental impact, there's the clean-up impact.
Then there's a disclosure of that.
Disclosure
too,
as well.
If they're going to rent or sell, there's a disclosure.
Extra cost of reinstatement, which is to bring things up to a level that they are now statutorily obliged to do. So those drug lab type claims are becoming frequency, they're becoming big, and they are impacting heavily upon on the cash flows of investors because of the timing involved.
So Charles, if you've got to declare it, you might even get a premium second time round. Say this has been a successful drug lab for the last 12 months, and you can almost move in straight away.
Yeah, I don't think so.
But probably not.
Yeah, I don't think so. There might be people looking for... It doesn't matter.
Let's change the subject
and let's talk
about your auction clearance rates.
Yeah, pretty good. They're starting to even out. With this time last year now.